at a pivotal point in Henry Louis Gates Jr.'s 1995 essay, 13 Ways of Looking at a Black Man, Professor Gates briefly considers the countervailing assertions of competing narratives in day-to-day discourse, writing, "People arrive at an understanding of themselves and the world through narratives. Narratives pervaded by school teachers, newscasters, authorities, and all the other authors of our common sense. Counter narratives are in turn the means by which groups contest that dominant reality and the fretwork of assumptions that supports it. Sometimes delusion lies that way, sometimes not. Lately, I've been thinking a lot about this notion of counter narratives, or what my other valued colleague, Professor Michael Eric Dyson, has called meta narratives. As I come to terms with the history and story-laden paintings of the 20th century artist Robert Colescott, one of the subjects of my next book on visual satire. Robert Colescott's paintings abound with stories. One might say his paintings are built upon narratives that themselves have figurative connotations, that meaning is derived from the depicted people and their implied actions. Populated with human beings of different shapes, sizes, colors, races, and sexes, Colescott's paintings invite audiences to look at the depicted bodies, to compare those bodies in relationship to themselves, and to sometimes see themselves in Colescott's figures. These figures serve as the narrative catalyst in his art, and the spectacles these figures invariably perform play a central role in amplifying each painting's reality quotient. Regardless of the painting's figural distortions or basis in fiction rather than fact. Thus, these actions become the source materials for extracting meaning from Robert Colescott's art, for generating discussions, and for triggering reactions. In the mid-1980s, Robert Colescott embarked on a series of paintings that were inordinately preoccupied with these counter-narratives, especially history's invisible black actors and catalysts, and with what might be best described as ironic montages that bore witness to our society's racial and class divisions. This body of work, which Colescott collectively designated Knowledge of the Past, is the key to the future, retained an acerbic feeling as if each painting goaded its viewers via sight gags and improbable compilations of unusual pictorial elements into a cynical yet heartfelt understanding of the story. An especially fascinating canvas from Robert Colescott's Knowledge of the Past is the Key to the Future series, subtitled Some Afterthoughts on Discovery, is one of the earliest examples of these ironic montages, in which perspectival logic and narrative continuities are abandoned and replaced by non-illusionistic space and collage-like painted elements. With the aid of the subtitle, we can deduce that from left to right, the 16th US President Abraham Lincoln, the 15th century Italian explorer Christopher Columbus, and the early 20th century Jamaican-born black nationalist Marcus Garvey are the real-life historical figures here who uphold and form a kind of mortar for Colescott's multi-layered meditation. The other figures in this painting, corporeal and skeletal, of assorted ethnicities, historical moments, and socioeconomic stations, supply their own information that, depending on the viewer's capacity to read the depicted accoutrements and gestures, comprise a compelling, if disparate, account of sightings, both historical and metaphorical. Taking in the entirety of Robert Colescott's cast of characters, it is a tale of sacrifice, exploitation, and myopia, all products of the myth that was America, and is seen in the half-naked, burden-laden man in the middle, an exegesis addressing what Professor Gates in his essay calls the shadowy figures of American history, or rather, our unnamed and unknown ancestors. In spite of its fragmentary chock-a-block format, knowledge of the past is the key to the future, some afterthoughts on discovery, contains enough visual data to back up its rather declarative and cerebral title. The assorted history lessons Robert Colescott presents from the fatal encounters between the conquistadors and the indigenous peoples in the age of discovery, to the exhuming of Emmett Till's lynched body and its horrific display in 1955, not only provides us with some hard truths about the American experience, but as Colescott pointedly reminds us, gives us some afterthoughts, reflections on hubris, gullibility, brutality, and the eternal allure of the spectacle. The false promise of emancipation, like the old world's futile quest for riches, is situated at the center of this painting and flanked on all sides by discoveries and findings that, as it turned out, did not quite measure up to what the seekers had envisioned would come to light. Neither an idealist nor a romantic, Robert Colescott preferred the role of a cynic and outsider, like the strolling devil-may-care woman on the painting's far left. This outsiderness invites a scornful and satirical perspective within each of his paintings, whether Colescott is the depicted bystander or, as is often the case, another protagonist plays that role. He is not an outsider endeavoring to point out and solve the world's problems, but rather an outsider who's at odds place within an imperfect world, and his wry observations about it are the stuff of an ironic, sarcastic, or mocking testimonial. Perhaps what knowledge of the past is the key to the future, some afterthoughts on discovery shows us, is that Robert Colescott's artistic counter-narratives force antagonists and friends to look deep, deep within their histories and their own respective closets, to pivot back and acknowledge the ghostly illusions therein, and then to seek out the inconvenient truth and the light. Thank you.